Many people think that it is done as a part of some kind of denominational tradition or denominational ritual, but we know better that Jesus Christ did not die for denominations. He died for the sins of the world. We know very well that denominations are not anything that the Bible even talks about. There is nothing condoned in the Word of God about a denomination, but that denominations were man-made things that were drawn up when sociological breakdowns happened in the church. That in the reality, many of you may not like this, denominations were started by nothing spiritual. Denominations were started because somebody got mad with somebody else and decided they were going to do their own thing because they didn't like what somebody else did. I know many of us like to lay our claim to what's Baptist, but the reality is the Baptist church got started because a man named John Smith had a disagreement about baptism for children. And because he had a disagreement with the Church of England that landed at Plymouth about the baptism of children, he started his own denomination and called it Baptist. Martin Luther got upset with the church because he was upset that the Pope was about to give out an award to Hitler, who had been a demonic and divisive force. And so Luther decided to start his own thing. John Calvin got upset with the church because they did not believe in predestination like he believed in predestination, and started his own church. Can I continue? The AME church got started because in Philadelphia at the 11th Street Episcopal Church, they got upset at the way blacks were being treated, and they started the African Methodist Episcopal Church. I think I'm doing a little teaching in here today. Even within the Baptist denomination, the factions got started for different things. The Southern Baptist Church, you know, that right-wing evangelical, we don't do nothing wrong. Yes, they got started because they did not want to free slaves. And there were white Baptists in the North who believed that blacks were equal to whites, but because the white preachers in the South did not believe blacks were equal, they decided to start the Southern Baptist Church. Even the National Baptist, that many of y'all think is the last thing since Jesus, only got started because of a disagreement about publishing rights of Sunday school material. Denominations have nothing biblical or spiritual about them. They were started because some man got mad with somebody else. We don't do the Lord's Supper because of denominationalism. There's the misnomer about when you do the Lord's Supper. Many people, because it has been the practice in most Baptist churches, really, to do the Lord's Supper on the first Sunday, but there is nothing in the Bible that says the Lord's Supper ought to happen on the first Sunday. There's really nothing in the Bible that says it ought to happen on Sunday. Jesus simply said, as often. Whether that's once a year, once a month, or once a week, or even once a day, just as often as you do it. God help me preaching here this day. There are even misnomers about how it ought to be done. We do it at the end of the service, but Jesus didn't say anything about doing it after the sermon. He never said do it here or do it there. He just said make sure you do it. There are misnomers between the Protestant church and the Catholic church about what happens at the Lord's Supper. There is the Catholic belief that there is some kind of transubstantiation, that the actual elements become the actual body and blood of Jesus Christ. But we don't believe that. We believe in consubstantiation, which simply means that symbolically the body and the bread represent the bread rather and the wine represent the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. There are many misnomers about what happens. The reality of the Lord's Supper is that Jesus gave it to the disciples as a reminder of what he was about to do on their behalf, so that when it was practiced in post-resurrection, it becomes a reminder to us that Jesus died for our sins when we could not die for ourselves. I don't know why you didn't shout on that. That every time you look at this table, it ought to be a reminder, number one, that I am a sinner. Let me say it one more time. It ought to be a reminder, number one, I didn't say that you are a sinner. I said that I am a sinner. Let me say it one more time. It ought to be a reminder that I am a sinner. It ought to be a reminder that I deserve judgment. But it ought to be a reminder that in spite of my wayward ways, and in spite of my sinful ways, and in spite of my bad decisions, he loved me enough to die to save me from the penalty of sin. Somebody ought to say hallelujah on that. You and I don't get what we deserve because of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. That he died. Touch somebody and tell him he died for my sins. But there's another thing that happens. When we take the bread and the drink, we digest in a symbolic, spiritual, and faithful way. We digest him. He declares himself as bread. So that in the symbolic way, when I eat the bread, I digest internally himself. So that taking the bread reminds me that he lives in me to make me more like him. And it ought to be your goal, and it ought to be my goal every day to be more and more like Jesus. God help me in here today. It ought not be my goal to be a better preacher. It ought not be my goal to be a better pastor. It ought to be my ultimate goal to be more and more like Jesus. And is there anybody other than me in this house who can say, Lord, make me more like Jesus? Make me to live like him. Make me to talk like him. Make me to love like him. Make me to see like him. Make me to walk. I want to be like Jesus. When I take him in, I become more and more like him. He said, this bread is me. So that I become like him. But I want you to notice very quickly that Jesus does not make the claim of the bread being him until after a series of events have taken place. He doesn't declare the bread his body at the beginning. He does several things before declaring the bread his body. He takes the bread through a process before he declares upon it a purpose. That you don't just pop up into purpose. God, I wish I could help somebody. You don't just show up and all of a sudden you're in your purpose. That God has to take us through a process before we are ready for a purpose. Because the ultimate goal of God is not your purpose. The ultimate goal of God is his glory. And God will never risk his glory by putting you in a purpose that you're not ready for yet. He'll hold the purpose and work on you until you're ready to handle it, so that when you get there, you'll have the character to keep you where the purpose is trying to take you. You gotta tell somebody it's a process. That's why you ought not get judgmental when people make mistakes. That's why you ought not act like you ain't never made a mistake when people fall, because it's part of the process. Shame on some of us holier than thou people who turn our noses up at people who fall or who make a mistake. It's part of the process. I just want you to notice the process. I'm not going to be long. First thing it says is that Jesus took. Can somebody bring me this bread down here, please? He took. Yeah. Deacon Armstrong just took the bread. Mm-hmm. Don't miss this. Thank you, Deacon. He took the bread. I'm going to keep it right up here. He took the bread from where it was to where I wanted it. You missed it because I saw it go past you. He took the bread from where it was to where I went. Yeah, it went past you one more time. He moved it from where it was to where I wanted it. God help me in here. So that the first thing that has to happen for you to get ready for process, Jesus has got to took you. Yeah, I feel like preaching today. He's got to move you from where you've been to where he desires you to be. Now, if you don't want to move, don't ask God to do anything with you. If you're satisfied where you are, don't ask God to make you anything. But if you're saying, make me more holy, make me more mature, make me who you want me to be, he's got to took you. You got to let him move. And I noticed when Deacon Armstrong took it, I didn't hear the bread ask where he was going. I wish I had some help in here this morning. I didn't hear the bread ask what you're doing, because when you're bread, you just trust God enough that even if you don't know where he's taking you, you know that wherever it is, it must be better than where you've been, because every round goes higher. You've got to be willing to let the Lord move you from one place to another. That sometimes you've got to be discerning enough to know when seasons are done. I'm not talking about places necessarily, but seasons in friendships. Oh, help me, Holy Spirit. Seasons in relationships. You've got to know that every now and then there's got to be a separation from where you were in order for the Lord to take you where he wants you to be. Now here is the struggle of the human mind. That where Deke took the bread from wasn't a bad place. You know, more often than not, when we hear, you know, God moved me, you know, that kind of thing, more often than not, the connotation is because where I am is negative, or because where I am is doing this to me, or because where I am is doing that to me, because where I am is not letting me grow. Y'all know I'm right. Move me from this job because I'm working around all these hellions. You ain't got to say amen, I know. Move me from here and move me from there. But sometimes the challenge is that the Lord wants to move you from somewhere that ain't bad. Every friendship is not bad. But maybe where God's about to take you, every friend can't go. He took it. It's a word of possession. Means that he possessed the bread. Huh? If the Lord is going to prepare you for purpose, you've got to let the Lord possess you. He's got to own. I wish you'd tell somebody he owns me. No, tell him like you mean it. He owns. Now, if he owns me, that means he has the rights to me. He doesn't have to ask me anything about what he wants to do. If he owns me, y'all not talking to me. He doesn't have to get my permission to do anything in my life. If he owns me. He took the bread. Now, watch. I want you to watch the order, because this mess you up. Then it says he blessed it. there is this disturbing. I was flipping the channels yesterday, and I got so disturbed on the word network. Watching this preacher, I don't know this preacher. I really don't. And he started talking about how the reason more young folk don't come to church. Watch this. It's because the adults in the church, the men in the church, only got 3 suits. And listen, I'm not making this up. And the 3 they got are shiny because they got to iron them all the time. And the dope dealer got 15 suits. And so because the man in the church ain't got but 3 suits, that's why the young folk don't want to be like him. I want to throw a brick at the TV. Because what he was saying was that the evidence that you're blessed isn't how much stuff you have. And that church folk ain't blessed because they ain't got a whole lot of clothes. The devil is a liar. You ain't blessed because of what you wear or where you live or what you're driving. You're blessed because he said so. You're blessed because he lives in you. You're blessed because he saved you. We got to get away from this church foolishness that wants to suggest that your blessings are tied to your money or your bank account or your closet or your garage. You can be a millionaire and be miserable. You can have a closet full of clothes and be depressed, but you can have 1 suit. 5 shirts. Change the shirt every day. Make the suit look different and wake up every day saying, this is the day that the Lord has made. I feel like preaching. Shall rejoice. Look at somebody and tell them, I'm blessed. Woo. I'm blessed. I'm blessed just because he said so. I'm not blessed because of what he gives me. You're not blessed because of what he gives you. You're blessed because he said so. That ought to make community in the church a little better. It ought to erase the spirit of snobbery in the church, where some folk think they're better than others because you live better than somebody. The devil is a liar. It ought to make for more love in the church so that you don't walk around thinking that you got something somebody else doesn't have. Everybody is blessed just because he said so. Tell somebody again, I know I'm blessed. No, really say it like you mean it. You got on a dress today you didn't have for 10 years, but look at somebody and tell them, I know I'm blessed. Hallelujah. Oh, bless his name. He blessed it. He blessed it. He it says that he blessed it. It's a Greek word that implies he spoke over it. But you're blessed because he speaks. Now here's where it gets good. It says he blessed it, and then y'all get a vacuum between services. I don't even know if I can do it. See, sometimes to break it, you got to hit it up against stuff, and it's got to hurt. I wish I had somebody in here today. Sometimes to be broken, you got to be knocked around and shaken. And I want you to notice that when it broke, some stuff fell off of it. That sometimes the Lord is breaking you because you got some stuff that needs to fall off. Bad attitudes, nasty attitudes, bad language, insecurity, depression. You got some stuff that needs to fall off of you. And every now and then you ought to tell him, break me until my bad habits fall off. Break me until my insecurity falls. Break me until my nasty habits. Break me. Break me till it hurts. Break me till I feel it. Break me till I shake some stuff. Break me. Oh, help me preach this thing in here today. The bread just fell apart all over the place. Watch this. The bread fell apart. Anybody here feel like you're falling apart? Come on, this is for the real folk. I want to talk to the real folk real quick. Anybody here, you're unemployed, you got laid off, ain't got enough money, wife walked away, husband walked away, children acting crazy, and you feel like you're falling apart? Can I give you a shout that might embarrass you because you're going to scream in your neighbor's ear? He blessed it before he broke it. Which means even when I'm falling apart, I'm still blessed. Even when life is rough, I'm still blessed. Even when I can't see my way, I'm still blessed. Even when I'm catching hell, I'm still. Now I want the folk in here who are honest enough to say I'm falling apart, but I'm blessed. And the devil should have killed me before I got my mind together. He thought I'd quit because I fell apart, but the devil is a liar. I'm blessed. Trouble on every side, but you're blessed. Can't see your way, but you're blessed. You ought to wake up every morning not magnifying what's broken and not magnifying what's falling apart, but magnifying what he declared, that you are blessed no matter how much you're falling apart. See, if you can just start declaring that, I just noticed something. This ain't even in the sermon, but I just noticed it. Because I started sniffing up here, trying to figure out what in the world am I smelling? And it's the bread. I didn't smell what was in it until I broke it. I promise you that ain't in the sermon, but the Holy Spirit just dropped that sometimes the real you and the aroma of the Holy Ghost that's in you can't come out until he breaks. Sometimes the Holy Ghost aroma doesn't know how to come out till you've been. Is there anybody in here? Has God had to break you and humble you? I know what I'm talking about in here today. That every now and then he'll have to humble you so that you'll learn how to let the aroma of the Holy Ghost out. He blessed. But Bishop, how am I blessed and I'm falling apart? How am I blessed and I'm broken? How am I blessed and my life is just a wreck? Do you see where the bread is? Tell somebody I'm blessed because I'm in his hand. I wish I had somebody in here. I don't care what else goes wrong, you're in his hands. Cancer in your body, but you're in his hands. Broke, but you're in his hands. Divorced, but you're in his hands. Depressed, but you're in his hands. And Mahal, you said he's got the whole world in his. He's got you and me, brother, you and me, sister, in his hands. I'm done. He took it, blessed it, broke it. Watch this. And he gave it to him, and then he said this. This is my body. Don't call this bread. Call it my body. That when you let him took you, and when you let him bless you, and when you let him break you, he'll transform you and give you a new meaning that you've never had before. God help me. So that it doesn't matter what you used to be. When the Lord speaks over you, he'll change who you were into what he wants you to be. I wish I had about 500 of y'all who can say, I know who I used to be. I know what I used to do, but since Jesus came into my heart, I wish you'd grab somebody by the hand and tell them, you don't have a clue who I used to be. You don't have a clue what I used to do, but what a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy on my soul, like the sea billows roll. Has he changed anybody in here? Has he given you a new name and given you a new start and given you a new talk and given you a new disposition and given you a new attitude? I'm done. Now watch this. It's his body, but it's still bread. So that it still is what it used to be. It just has a new purpose. See, I don't have time for these saints who get saved and now all of a sudden they so different. They can't talk to nobody. You can't hold a conversation with them. They don't know how to joke. Don't know how to crack a joke, crack a smile. Oh, y'all don't get quiet. You know what I'm talking about. They so saved that they come in church trying to look all deep. And you try to have a conversation with them. If you ain't said Lord by the fifth word, they walk away from you. You ain't spiritual. But the Lord said, I'm looking for a few folk. Watch this. Who can say, I'm the same person I used to be. I just got a new purpose. If I danced in the street, I'ma dance in the church. If I was loud on the corner, I'ma be loud in the church. I wish you'd look at somebody and tell them, I'm the same OG. The same person I used to be. I just got a new purpose. I'ma come get some of y'all dancers. I'ma come get some of you loud folk. What? When I think, there you go, of the goodness of Jesus. And all he's done for me, my soul cries out, hallelujah. I wish I had somebody who can say, I'm not going to change who I am. Now the flip is true. If I was quiet in the world, don't think I done got stuck up because I don't run into church. That's just who I am. If I wasn't loud on the corner, don't get mad because I don't holler in the church. Look at somebody and tell them, that's who I am. But if I don't mess with you, don't you mess with me. Because when I look back over my life and start to think things over, I can truly say that I've been blessed. High five your neighbor and tell him I've got a testimony. Through many dangers, toils and sin, I have already come. Was grace that brought me saved us far. Grace shall lead me on. I got to get out of here, y'all. I can't holler too much. But is there anybody in here who can stand on your feet and declare, break me, bless me? Grab somebody by the hand and tell them he blessed me. And I know I'm blessed from the top of my head to the sole of my feet. I'm blessed in the city, blessed in the field, blessed when I come, blessed when I go. Ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? All right. All right. I wish I had the doctor in here. All right. Bless, 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 bless. Bless, I'm blessed, I'm blessed, I'm blessed. I dare you tell people, but I'm blessed, I'm blessed.
Subscribe to Brother Rollins' Videos for Christ on YouTube. We post brand new content every week with powerful preaching from ministers and pastors all across the nation that seek to encourage people all over the world. through the word of Jesus Christ. You will also find gospel songs and old-time hymns that have inspired generations of Christians. Subscribe today and hit the bell so you never miss new content. YouTube.com/Brother Rollins. Spell it. B-R-O-T-H-A Rollins. Brother Rollins videos for Christ on YouTube.